the Secretary General of the United Nations has had to face this and say the child sexual abuse is a problem of the entire United Nations. There's just this torrent of sexual abuse pouring out of United Nations and their affiliated organizations. The man who wrote the implementation handbook for the Convention on the Rights of the Child, the international document that's supposed to guide nations and people in protecting the rights of children, was convicted of child rape. He was convicted of sodomy of a child. The UN has peacekeeping troops throughout the world using food as an incentive for children to perform sex acts on soldiers. It's abhorrent. In order to get food, and nothing was done, even though people at the UN had apparently been told, even farther up the line, and nothing was done. And so there was one man who decided to take some action.
Hi everyone, I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse with the Ruth Institute, and welcome to this episode of the Dr. J Show. Today, I'm delighted to have as my guest Kimberly Ells, who is a policy advisor for Family Watch International, an organization that she's going to tell you all about. Kim, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much, Dr. Morse.
Yes, I think you and I met years ago when you guys put on a Stand for the Family conference out in Utah.
Yes.
And I came out for it.
Yes, that's right. Several years ago, we became acquainted there. It's delightful to meet you then.
Well, thank you. And you've been doing good stuff all along. Tell people a little bit about yourself and the organization that you're involved in and why you decided to write this particular book that we're going to be talking about.
Okay. Well, I'm first and foremost a mother, and I have five children. How this all started for me getting into this arena of sexual rights and this whole pro-family activity was several years ago. I think it was 2013. I was looking online for just totally unrelated material, and I came across something that was so alarming to me that I couldn't even believe that it was real. And so I got digging into it some more, and what it was a document produced by International Planned Parenthood Federation. It's called the Exclaim document about sexual rights for children. And I didn't know such a thing existed. And I was very appalled at what I was reading in it. The document presented sexual rights to children as if that's something that was inherently theirs to claim, with no connection to marriage or accountability or childbearing or anything. It's just seeking after sexual pleasure is in itself a right for minors, for children. And and I thought, wait, at first I couldn't believe it was in fact real, because it was so, you know, disturbing. And so that day I decided that if this is real, this is not going to exist in the world without me fighting it. And so that's how I began. And so I had no idea at the time where that would lead me, you know, on through the United Nations and learning so much and becoming acquainted with so many groups and people such as yourself. So that was kind of the starting point for me of being even politically active really at all and understanding what the international agenda was as far as sexual rights for kids.
So this is very interesting, and this is an important point for Ruth Institute followers to understand. When the United Nations and the gender ideologues say children's rights, what they mean is the children's rights to have sex without their parents knowing. That's what they mean by children's rights. Am I right?
Unfortunately, yes. And there are other things. Obviously, they promote some beneficial children's rights. But when you say children's rights, most people think of, protective rights for children. You know, protecting them from outside influences and harmful things. Unfortunately, what has become a large part of the sexual rights agenda at the United Nations and beyond is children's sexual rights. Rights to have sex, rights to access sexual information without your parents' knowledge, and so forth.
Right. And so at the Ruth Institute, we sometimes talk about children's rights. So that's why I want to make very sure people, you know, understand what we have always meant when we say children's rights.
Because
Yeah, we mean children's rights to their parents, children's rights to have a relationship with their parents, children's right to know their identity, the identity of their parents. That's what we think is a children's right. And we think traditional Christian sexual morality all work together to protect those rights of children. And now you got these other people coming along using similar language enough that you might think, oh, these are good people. But what they mean is something 180 degrees opposite of what the protection of children, like you were saying, protection of children has always meant.
That's right. And it's disturbing because, of course, who would be against children's rights? That's a very valid concept that virtually all people would be on board with. And so, like you say, it unfortunately it has been corrupted.
That's right. That's right. You got to pay attention to the language, people. It's very important. So, so you're now involved in going back and forth to the United Nations to be involved in various ways. Tell us a little bit about the organization that you work with and what you guys try to accomplish at the United Nations.
Well, very soon after the experience that I shared with you about finding these things online, I became acquainted with Family Watch International, and they were the ones who were working to expose these things and work against them. And so I very quickly decided that I wanted to be on board with those efforts. Sharon Slater is the international president and has done a lot of great things across the world to protect children and the family. And so Family Watch does many wonderful things to protect the family, involved, as you say, directly at the United Nations, as well as holding conferences and other events. We've recently started a series of webinars educating people about these issues, especially UN-oriented issues.
Another project that I'm aware of that Family Watch does is the whole Stop Sex Ed program here in the United States.
Right. Well, just to clarify, our stance is not entirely opposed to sex ed. It's comprehensive sexuality education specifically that we oppose because of the nefarious and troubling things that it presents to children. Comprehensive sexuality education is often presented as being a medically accurate, parent-friendly, child-centric, you know, healthy, wonderful thing for children, often presented as a way to reduce sexually transmitted infections and so forth, and to have all of these great outcomes. But when you get looking closer into the actual curriculum, which I do in my book, it's very troubling. And just in a nutshell, we could go in the book that I've written, I go through many examples, three whole programs citing actual quotations from the text that are very troubling. But in a nutshell, this is the philosophy of comprehensive sexuality education, that we basically tell children that seeking sexual pleasure is your right. And this is how you can start. You can start by sexually stimulating yourself. And then when you're ready, with no connection to marriage or long-term commitment, you can seek pleasure with other people in any combination, really. And then throwing in, by the way, the substance of your body doesn't really matter whether you're male or female, and abortion is great, and your parents are wrong. That's summing up CSE in a nutshell. Those are the principles that are taught. Now, there are some other valuable and valid principles that are also presented in many of these programs, but woven into them is some very destructive ideology, and even planting seeds and urging children forward to seek out sexual experience, which is very troubling to most parents.
Yes, you know, not long ago I interviewed Sue Ellen Browder about her experience as a fake news journalist back in the day when she wrote for Cosmo, and she made this distinction that's exactly appropriate here. She says, half-truth is the most dangerous thing because you can't tell which half. It's the true thing, you know, so here you are, you know, with a program that purports to be one thing, and woven into it are all these things that are really very disturbing and completely incorrect and completely at odds with what it claims to be and so on. And so, you know, an unwitting person, an unsuspecting person would go through it, and they might be going, there's something wrong with this, but you can't figure out which part of it is wrong because some of it seems authoritative and correct and so on. So it's very insidious, don't you think?
It is, but it's getting bolder, and a lot of the programs you do have to pick through. But let me just share one quote as an example from one. This is from actually the Exclaim document that I originally found. It says, sexual pleasure is an important part of being human for everyone, no matter what age, no matter if you're married or not, and no matter if you want to have children or not. That's pretty blatant.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
pretty clear.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. We got to back up here. We've been talking about your book, but we haven't even named your book. What's the name of your book, Kim, and why did you write it?
Oh, right. It's called The Invincible Family, and then why the global campaign to crush motherhood and fatherhood can't win. The idea that women are naturally empowered creatures, and I believe hold the position of greatest power in the world. And I felt like that story needed to be told, that it wasn't told in the way it needed to be told. And so that's what I hope to accomplish.
And what do you mean by that, that women are empowered? In what sense do you mean that, Kim? Because obviously people mean a lot of different things by that language. Right. So what do you mean when you say that?
Yeah. What I mean, just to get to the kind of the crux of I guess the main genesis of the book, is that the relationship that is produced before birth and at birth between the mother and the child is the substance of society. That's the thing upon which society rests. And the fact that the child belongs to the mother, that's something that has been honored and recognized in virtually every culture and every time. That when a mother bears a baby, it's hers. It's her responsibility. It's hers to cherish. It's hers to teach, along with, of course, its father. Mm-hmm. The babies belong to their parents. This is a basic thing. And this is one of the things that's being challenged internationally and even through comprehensive sexuality education, ideologies, and so forth. So what I mean is, it's widely known, if you're going to be savvy, if you want to have power, right, political power, if you want to have influence, you need to get to the young, right? And that's what so many regimes throughout history have tried to do, is to get to the hearts and minds of the young, because if you influence people when they're young, they're likely to continue to embrace those ideologies as they grow older. Well, if you'll notice, when a baby arrives on Earth, where are they put? Into the lap, literally, of a mother, into the arms of a mother. And so it's mothers, in cooperation, of course, with fathers, that have the that hold the minds of the young, hold their bodies, hold their minds, have the greatest influence over the beliefs of individual people. Which in turn, what does that mean? They affect the beliefs of the entire world. And it happens one person at a time, one baby at a time. And that's how it's meant to be. And in that way, it's cradled in love. Like the basic and fundamental teachings that a child receives are from a place of love from their mother, from their father. Now, of course, there are some exceptions to that. And it doesn't always work ideally, but that is the ideal. Right. And in fact, that's the way that the anatomy of people is designed. And whether you believe that that's designed by God and put in place, or whether you believe that that has evolved over time, it somewhat doesn't matter, because that's the way that it is.
Right.
A woman and a man together produce new life. Right. That's it. Right. And that life is a real breathing baby who is ready to be, it needs to be cared for and ready to learn. And that's the launching place from which life begins. And therefore that's the position of greatest power. And I think so many women have been, even myself at times, have been somewhat misled. And women, as you say, women's empowerment these days means something very different than what I've just mm-hmm. described. It means that you need to remove yourself from your family and remove yourself from teaching your children, because either that's so unimportant that it's beneath you, or it's so important that professionals at a school or whatever need to do it. And so, yeah, in modern, lately, in women's empowerment has transitioned to mean career power or money earning right. power holding a political office, which are all valid things. But the responsibility of mothers and fathers is first and foremost to their children. And that's where their greatest and most and their longest lasting power is manifested.
And the other thing about that is that the family has always been the target of every totalitarian regime you can ever think of. Every totalitarian regime wants to get in there and get that baby off the mother's lap. Somehow or another, disrupt the what the family does. If you want to control everything and everybody, you got to put a stop to that. And so one ideology after another has sought to do that. And honestly, for my money, the gender ideology, the sexual revolutionary ideology, is the most pernicious of all the modern ideologies, because it goes right to the heart of the thing. And it really is empowering many, many abusive things that people don't want to connect the dots to,
Right. Exactly. Which goes along with your book, The Sexual State, the things that you talk about in there. And you pointed out something important that I do review in my book. The fact that all totalitarian regimes through time have sought to destroy the family because it works against their power, That's because the family has such great power, right. And people recognize that, and you have to dismantle that in order to get to children, in order to control the future. And so in my book, I do discuss the origins of socialism specifically, and also feminism, and differentiating, of course, between feminism that is good and positive and has allowed us to, you know, go to school and have legal rights. Of course, those are good things. But feminism, the very the root of it, as I illustrate in the book, has been wrong, has been corrupt. And so both socialism and feminism, and now, as you mentioned, sexual radicalism are the three main ideologies and movements going afoot right now that are seeking really to destroy the family. And a lot of people don't understand that. They just think socialism is about equality. They think feminism is about revering women. They think sexual radicalism is about love equaling love. But as you said, at the root, they seek to destroy the family.
They usurp
the power that it has.
That's right. That's right. And that's the power of the title of your book, The Invincible Family, that you feel in the end that it's got enough strength that it can keep coming back. Tell us a little bit about what goes on at the United Nations.
Okay, well, just so launching, when I first went to the United Nations a few years ago, I went to what's called the Commission on the Status of Women, held in New York City annually every spring. And so it's specifically supposed to be focused on women's rights, women's issues, and so forth. And walking in, everywhere present was this visual of a man, and man equals woman, or woman equals man, like the kind of symbols that you would see like on a restroom, you know, man, woman, woman equals man. And that kind of encapsulates the ideology that's pushed there. Now, that could mean, that could be positive, right? That men and women are equally important. Of course they are. That they should be paid the same for the same work. Of course they should. You know, there's many ways that that could be interpreted positively. However, it became obvious as I went to different events and so forth that really what is meant by that is that men and women are exactly the same. And which they're not, which should be evidenced by the fact that we're all at a big event called the Commission on the Status of Women, which indicates that they're
equal men. Wait a minute. Can we substitute the two equal things? Normally you can substitute the men and everything will be the same.
it seeks to negate the complementarity of men and women. So if you think about it, if you are going to make women and men exactly the same, what do you have to do? One thing you have to do is eliminate the differences that women have that are unique, and you have to, in fact, reduce her power. What are some of the things that make women unique? Being able to conceive, being able to grow a human in their womb, being able to give birth, being able to nurse a baby. And so these are unique to women. And so if you want to make men and women the same, you need to work at eliminating those things.
Right. Either eliminating them or neutralizing them. Their first move was, having babies is a burden on women. They can't produce. They can't be in the labor force. It's in the way. So we're going to neutralize that with contraception plus abortion. And now that train keeps moving along because nobody's done a darn thing to stop it. And now they're to the point where the body itself is at stake, right? That that your body and my body, it's not even significant that we have XX or XY chromosomes. Doesn't even matter.
Right, now.
You can dress it up.
Yes. So, you know, the whole issue with, well, you can just abort the consequences of sex. Well, you can just, you know, contracept and abort things away and it doesn't matter. But what you're getting at now is, so now we're trying to limit the differences between men and women's bodies and their functions. And even worse now with gender ideology is we're saying you can just cut off body parts and stitch on, you know what I mean? And that you can just swap.
Right,
that is rooted in that ideology that I mentioned about man equals woman. They're interchangeable. They're the same. It doesn't matter. You can infuse hormones in whoever you want to produce whatever effect you want, which, you know, has proven to be extremely, extremely destructive.
Tell people a little bit about why it matters what goes on at the UN.
It matters actually a lot, as I've learned for myself over the past few years. And just there's several ways that the workings of the United Nations infiltrate society. And a few of those are, first of all, when the United Nations puts forth a document or a treaty or something, then our Congress, you know, can ratify the treaty by a 2/3 vote. So the things that are adopted there, we then can officially adopt as a nation, regardless of the conflicts that may exist between our constitution and our laws. And so it presents a very problematic situation. Also, cities themselves can adopt UN movements, treaties and so forth, and that has been happening. Also, when the UN puts forth a document and it's ratified by all these countries across the world and seeming to be endorsed by all these different entities, then it gives it clout that it doesn't really have. It doesn't have any legal force, but it gives it clout. Because look, everyone in the world agrees on these things, even though the representatives who go to the United Nations are not elected by the people, and they're not, you know, beholden to the cheap people or anything. And so, but then the courts in individual countries, our country included, then cite international documents, UN documents often, to support their rulings. So there's legally a very real way that interacts with our laws and with things that go forth in our country. Furthermore, cultural attitudes are very much affected by the workings of the United Nations. I'll give you an example. I went to an event that was called Step It Up for Gender Equality. This was just maybe 3 years ago or so. And they're kicking off this big thing where we were going to have in advertising and all kinds of things, we were going to have total gender equality. What have you noticed in the last few years? I've noticed a ton of censoring of commercials that you can't show women preparing food or taking care of babies. You know, we've all seen these things coming out. Well, where's one source that's coming from? The United Nations. Not only there, but I don't find it a coincidence that the Step It Up for Gender Equality thing happened. And then there's all this trickle down through advertising and TV shows, you know, that promote these things. And then another thing that specifically I talk in depth about in the book is how UN agencies seek to infiltrate and are infiltrating the education systems of the world, including our education systems. Mm-hmm. And you may think, as I did, well, certainly not my cute little school in my sweet little community. But I'm sorry to say it's on the way. If it's not there yet, the implementation is there. It's on the way for all these ideologies to be delivered to your young children, basically, whether you like it or not.
And what's the mechanism by which the United Nations and its ideology works its way down into local school boards? How does that happen?
I'll just give you a very brief overview, but do know that I have an entire chapter devoted to this in the book.
You got to buy this book. Okay, just say stop. Public service announcement from the Ruth Institute. You need to buy this book. Okay, go ahead, Kim.
Okay, thank you. So there's these very big, well-funded UN agencies like UNESCO, UNICEF, UNFPA, and so forth. And they have a great deal of clout and influence and money because all the nations of the world contribute to them. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Then they've established the Sustainable Development Goals, which are the goals for the world supposedly for the next, you know, 15 years. And then embedded in those, however, is these ideologies that we've talked about, sexual rights for children, although it doesn't say it in those terms. Right. There's language in there that allows, you know, for the interpretation that, oh, we need to provide comprehensive sexuality education for all children all across the globe for their health in the name of children's health. And that's one way that is often gotten in there. And then
Hold on just a moment. Sustainable Development Goals. Maybe I clarify one thing with you, because I think I know where that's going. Isn't reducing population part of that program of sustainable development? I mean, isn't slowing population growth a part of that?
Yes. Of course, they don't necessarily say it in those terms, but that's basically the crux of the whole idea, is that we have to live on this planet sustainably. And what's meant by that in their eyes is, yes, controlling the population through contraception and abortion and so forth, getting women to choose not to have children in the name of saving the world and so forth like that. Making the world sustainable for everyone, meaning we have to equalize income, you know, which is this socialistic, the crux of socialism, you know, and so forth, make it sustainable. We have to stop relying on fossil fuels because we're ruining the earth and so forth. So you're absolutely right. Although it's draped in much more appealing terms.
Of course, right.
The idea is that we have to save the earth by limiting its population and managing things in that way. So yeah.
Right.
So the United Nations entities, agencies, major agencies, they openly partner with many different NGOs and organizations. One of the main ones that they partner with, and this is not a secret, is International Planned Parenthood Federation, which of course makes perfect sense if you want to promote the things that Planned Parenthood is doing. And of course, in the process, International Planned Parenthood and its affiliates all over the world are enriched by how sexualizing children, getting them to need their services, such as contraception and sexual disease testing and so forth. And then, of course, abortion. And then that enriches International Planned Parenthood Federation. And so they openly partner. And
it's crony capitalism. It's crony capitalism, which everybody hates. Socialists and capitalists alike despise crony capitalism. But it's crony capitalism with a little ideological pace, you know, a label stuck on it, and so it's okay. You know, it's okay for this semi-government, really government thing called the United Nations to be enriching a sort of private, public organization called Planned Parenthood. That's perfectly okay.
Right. Yeah. Very interesting. And so, yes. Yeah, so we go down UN agencies partnering with all of these entities. Then we have the Sustainable Development Goals, and then enter the OECD, the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development. And they facilitate, one of the main things that they facilitate is PISA testing in schools, the Program for International Student Assessment. And so their goal, it's very much the same philosophy as the Common Core. Everyone needs to be taught the same things. That's how we get equality. We can't have local control. We need big control so that everything is the same. And so most parents are concerned with the amount of testing that they see going on in schools and are kind of concerned, well, what are the questions, what's being asked, and so forth. And I go through all this in the book. But there is a very concerted and organized effort to test children in schools according to these certain standards that then the schools get basically ranked on their students' performance on the tests. And then, of course, the schools need to, the idea is the schools need to align. And eventually, it appears that the goal is to have them, if a school wants to be funded and continue to function, then they will have to come up for their students so that they pass these certain assessments. The problem is, what principles are being taught on those assessments? Is it just purely math and you know, spelling? Well, no. As it turns out, there's a whole under the questions belie a whole other ideology and pushing sexual rights. And there's an ability for schools, increasing ability technologically for children to be tested and assessed. And this is a tricky part, not just on their academic success. That's how it started. But guess what they've moved into now? Social and emotional learning, assessing children's attitudes about various social issues. And once you start to do that, it becomes clear that the goal is not just to assess the children's attitudes, but to influence. And there's some very chilling examples that I give in the book of that. And so those things are in place. And then coming down closer to the schools, then all these agencies and their various partners partner with more local agencies. And this is happening in my state. And then down to your local school board. And in my state, recently in the state school board meeting, they admitted that their pilot program for a student assessment was based on the global standards. And most parents don't know that and don't know what it means.
Right.
And so anyway, that's kind of the rough overview. There's a lot more detail that can be gone into about that in the book. But there is a very definite line being developed. It is developed from the United Nations and their ideologies down to your child's classroom.
That's right. The fact is, these things are going on, and you should not let yourself be bullied out of pursuing this, okay? So if you don't believe what we're saying here, take a look at Kim's book, The Invincible Family, published by Regnery Press. Take a look at it, and look at the footnotes. She's got a lot of documentation in there. Check out the documentation. Don't take our word for it, okay? This is not some kind of fake news thing. You can follow those links, follow those breadcrumbs yourself. She's got them all there for you. So,
and I used to be one of those people that thought, well, that sounds, wait, really? You know, I have a colleague that knows about all these things, and I'm like, are you sure? And so yeah, I decided that I wasn't going to put anything in the book that I didn't research myself. And so I found these things for myself through my own research, you know, with outside support. But it's all truly happening.
That's right.
The intent is to influence what? The young children.
That's right. That's
which
right.
is what? Which is the job of the mothers and fathers.
That's right. That's right. The mask is off, so to speak, that many within positions of power have used this as an opportunity for arbitrary power. And it, too many people have seen that up close and personal, you know, in terms of how their churches are being treated so differently from other organizations and so on. Look, there's something going on here that is not in your interest, mm-hmm. and we want you to get involved. There were a number of very, very interesting things about this book. There were two things that really bugged me. One was just how blatant and how extreme some of the gender ideology people really are. You quoted a few people. Can you give people a quote or two from some of the people who are kind of currently involved in some of the things that they're saying?
Along with Firestone, an early feminist of the 1970s, and one of her statements is still very relevant. She said that the goal of radical feminism is not just to eliminate male privilege, but to eliminate the sex distinction itself, so right. that sex no longer matters culturally. Right. And that, lo, these decades later, we're seeing that in, come to pass in real time. Right. And so, for a modern example, Sophie Lewis. And the name of her book is Full Surrogacy Now, Feminism Against Family. Oh. And so it's the subtitle there that's very telling, Feminism Against Family. She outright calls for the destruction of the family, for communism to take its place, for women to relinquish the possessorship or claim over their own babies. And her idea is, with the title Full Surrogacy Now, is that everyone should be bearing babies for other people. That right. the babies should not belong right. to anyone, because in her view, that's a violation of their rights right. to be, in a sense, owned by, I say, belong to their parents. And, right. and she says that's the great, you know, source of evil and oppression in the world, is that children are obligated to belong to their parents.
See, they're living in fantasy. They're living in a fantasy where children don't need their parents, where mm-hmm. human connection is a non-factor, that you can be connected, that you don't need to be connected to anybody, but if somebody takes care of you and takes care of your physical needs, you'll be okay. It's yep. complete fantasy. It's a, such a distortion of the view of the human person. Right. So anyway, continue with Miss Lewis and surrogacy.
Right. So she put out a couple of articles just lately in the COVID-19 crisis, saying now's the perfect time to destroy the family. Let's not forget about destroying the family. And she's very disturbed that people are quarantining with their families. She finds that objectionable. Love grows best in the family. Most right. often. So you can't just say, well, we're not going to have love of family. We're just going to love everyone. You have to start with love of somebody. And right. it starts with your mom and dad and your baby. That's where love it grows. And so anyway, she says that we don't know what the alternative will look like. So it's as if we're saying, let's just explode the family. Let's just blow it to bits. And then let's see what great thing right, is going to take right, its place. Right, right. There is no great thing that's going to take its place, because it is the primal thing. And actually what the globalists, you know, at United Nations and so forth are gunning for is that global government, global rule of equality will replace the family. So let's not pretend that once we explode the family, that we're all going to just have this great freedom from those familial bonds and just be so full of love and have no oppression and whatever. There will be oppression. There will be great suffering. And the state trying to, especially a global state trying to take the place of the family, is not going to work.
So let me just pause right here and state what I consider to be the Ruth Institute position. God's design for human life and human reproduction is that every child be the embodiment of their parents' love. That is what God wants for us, that the child is the embodiment of an act of love between their mother and father. And in this way, God is mirroring on earth what goes on in the divine life of the Trinity. You know, that God is love, and this is a little reflection of it. The child is the embodiment of love, of the parents' love. And that's fundamentally what's wrong with surrogacy, is that, and all of the artificial methods, is that they are, you know, they have nothing to do with love. They have to do with mm-hmm. With commerce and desire. The human will is definitely involved, but human love, not, you know, maybe, but only incidentally, you know.
Right. And that's one of the beautiful things about it. Like you said, that this isn't limited by economics or any other thing. A mother, a father, a child. That's right. How life begins. All people have that. All people can experience it. And that's the beauty of it, because people don't just appear on the earth in a cabbage patch, as this tale goes. They come to specific mothers so that those mothers can claim and take care of them. And the thing is, every person, the design is, it doesn't matter where on earth you live, what your circumstances are, you have that. And that's why I say that the family is invincible, because it's self-replicating. And it's the thing that regenerates itself no matter what else we do, you know, no matter what other regimes come to power and other things, you know, nations rise and fall. But what stays constant? Man, woman, baby, regenerating itself, regenerating love itself as that happens. And so that's why I say it's invincible, because you can't, unless you stop anatomy, which is what we're trying to do with the gender ideology, you can't stop the family. And if things fall to rubble in society, what will rise up? Is it going to be, it will be the family. It's not going to be some distant organization of random people. It's going to be a man and a woman and their child, their children. The family will always rise up, because that's the way that it organically happens. That's the way that the design of human bodies works. So the family, you can reject it, you can crush it, you can rip it to bits, but it will always come back.
The one other really disturbing thing that I found in your book had to do with child sexual abuse. Mm-hmm. Because with all this high-sounding rhetoric that we've got over here, you also report numerous cases of people within the United Nations agencies and so on being implicated in pedophile rings and so on. It seems to me the ideology is leaving everybody a sitting duck for sexual predators. That's what I think.
Even recently, within the last couple of years, the Secretary General of the United Nations has had to face this and say that child sexual abuse is a problem of the entire United Nations. We haven't seen over the last, 20 plus years of these offenses being committed and documented, there's been talk about stemming this problem, but nothing effective has really been done. And so you're right, there's just this torrent of sexual abuse pouring out of United Nations and their affiliated organizations and so forth, and this, I find it very disturbing as well, and any person would. It's interesting though, because we have all these sexual offenses being committed by UN connected personnel, not always UN personnel, but UN connected, and then also this fight for children's sexual rights. So you see, those are in conflict, because if we're upset about the sexual abuse of children, why are we also at the United Nations level promoting children's sexual rights? Well, they would say, well, if it's consensual, that's different. No, if it's a child, it's not different. Right. And anyway, just as one example.
Yes.
The Convention on the Rights of the Child is a very famous document. It's been ratified by most of the nations of the world, except the United States. Anyway, so this document purports to protect the rights of children. Well, it turns out that the man who wrote the implementation handbook for the Convention on the Rights of the Child was convicted of child rape. He was convicted of sodomy of a child. And this he was involved apparently with a 12 or 13 year old boy when it started. They had a relationship over apparently 3 years. Years later, he was, brought to task. He was finally accused of those crimes and pled guilty and was convicted and put in jail. This should give us a huge clue as to the intentions of the people pushing these documents and these ideologies. If the man who's writing the implementation handbook for the Convention on the Rights of the Child is a child rapist, that is a huge red flag. Mm-hmm. And I understand that not all people who are involved with the Convention on the Rights of the Child and so forth are child rapists. I fully understand that. But the fact that key people are is very troubling. And it should tell us something about what the Convention on the Rights of the Child is going to facilitate and allow. It's going to free children up for sexual activity.
Right.
Who's interested?
If they're no longer under the supervision of their parents, if you've taught them to distrust their parents, they're much more vulnerable to somebody who's nice to them. Seems like children in refugee camps, who are about the most vulnerable people out there, somebody giving them something that they want or need or something in exchange for sex.
You're absolutely right. The UN has peacekeeping troops throughout the world, and those aren't officially UN employees or whatever. They're troops taken from countries around the world who then help to keep the peace in various war-torn or places where there's upheaval. And unfortunately, there's been example after example after example that I cite in the book of peacekeeping troops sexually abusing children, and exactly as you say, using food as a incentive for children to perform sex acts on soldiers. It's abhorrent. There was a 13-year-old boy in one of the things that was exposed who said that he couldn't remember how many times he was forced to commit sex acts on a soldier in order to get food to survive. Yeah. And that needs to be addressed with vigor. And what happened in one instance, I believe it was 2014, in this Central African Republic, there was peacekeeping troops, and it became known to some people. Some kids started saying, hey, this is what's going on. And the French keeping troops were committing these offenses, and nothing was done. Even though people at the UN had apparently been told, even farther up the line, and nothing was done. And so there was one man who decided to take some action and approach the French authorities and start the process to get some change and to protect these children. Well, guess what happened? He was later disciplined for breaching protocols. It's abhorrent that a man who was trying to stop the immediate and ongoing abuse of children was disciplined for doing that. That's right. Troubling. And so right. while the United Nations talks about stopping these things, what's actually being done? Are we screening people before they join the United Nations for, you know, background checks and so forth? Are we putting in place whistleblower protections? Those things have not been happening. Those things need to happen.
For me, as a Roman Catholic, the whole business, the revelations with Theodore McCarrick in 2018, of course, were extremely upsetting. We commissioned this study. Our Father Sullins did this big report and so on and so forth. And since that time, what I've noticed is all these different organizations and all different sectors of society having similar problems, having similar ways of grooming victims, similar ways of dismissing the claims of victims, similar pattern of abuse of power from the top down, people getting cover, you get the bad guys get cover because they have friends in high places. These patterns are repeating themselves throughout society. And so what I would say to people of faith, because now other churches are having these problems too, not just Catholic. You guys, it's up to us. If we don't put a stop to it, if we don't figure out how to deal with it and put a stop to it, nobody else will. What do you think, the United Nations is going to ride in and solve this problem? On what, you know, come, the troops are going to come over the hill and rescue us? It's not going to happen. The government's going to help us? Jeffrey Epstein did not kill himself, just for the record. That's my opinion. Jeffrey Epstein didn't kill himself. You know, so it's on us to deal with this, and dealing with the United Nations is a big part of it, because they are specifically promoting an ideology which is in effect grooming everybody to be victims. This stuff in the school is a kind of social cultural grooming of sexual abuse victims. That's my opinion, based on what you said and what you know, what I read in your book, based on the work that you guys are doing in the sex ed field in the United States. It's softening people up to give a pass to things that they shouldn't be given a pass to. Mm-hmm. And it's emboldening predators, and it's disarming victims, and it's got to stop. This is, to me, one of the most insidious parts of the sexual revolution.
Yeah, insidious is the right word. To tell a young child that it's their right to have sex, what does that do? It just makes them completely vulnerable to right. sexual advances of other people, including adults, and it's just completely unacceptable.
And then to also be sowing seeds of mistrust between themselves and their parents. That's the other very insidious part of it. So, you know, we've only got a few minutes left here, Kim. So I'd like you to tell people a little bit about the work of Stop Sex Ed. See, I think it's called. Tell people about the material your organization has put together about comprehensive sexuality education that anybody in the United States can easily find and get involved with. Tell people about it.
Okay. So, as you know, we've talked about some alarming things and things that are going on at the United Nations. And so what can you do? Just throw up your hands? No. There are some very concrete things that we can and must do that everyone can do. First and foremost, we need to teach our families what we believe about sex, marriage, gender, and the family. And we need to do it specifically, intentionally, on an ongoing basis, not just a one-time conversation. We need to have conversations about these things in our families and create opportunities to do that. So how do we do that? You mentioned there's many great resources. Obviously, the Ruth Institute has a lot of great resources. Family Watch International that I'm affiliated with has many great resources. The place that I would point people to very first is stopcse.org. stopcse.org. If you're interested in the children's sexual rights movement and what can be done about it and understanding more what it is, stopcse.org. And there's examples galore of various comprehensive sexuality education programs, as well as examples of United Nations programs that push sexual rights for children. And so there's examples there that you can fully explore and get educated on this topic. And then, of course, you'll want to join, well, if you're so inclined, you can join forces with people near you who are fighting comprehensive sexuality education. And there are ways to go to the website, and there's ways that you can connect with others who want to be involved. Again,
if I'm not mistaken, now straighten me out if this is wrong, if I'm not mistaken, don't you have a state-by-state listing of local people or what the local laws are? Do you guys have that? Tell people about that. Yeah.
Well, still in process. We're always adding to it, but you'll find many different things at stopcse.org, as well as, you know, clicking on your state, finding out what's going on there. We're building that resource for people. If you click on policy briefs at our website, there's tons of information for you to read about all of these topics to become better informed, so that then you can teach your family more effectively and understand these things yourself. And then the last thing, so teach your family, go to stopcse.org and learn about that and expose and oppose CSE. And then lastly is buy great books that teach the truth and read them with your family. And hopefully one of those books will be my book. I hope it will be helpful to the families. That's why I've written it. What I would like to have happen is to knock the legs out from under the international efforts to crush the family. And I want to do that by arming women, by telling women and men, fathers, the truth about their power, the truth about their position. So, but not just my book, read great books, read stories of socialist nations and the oppression that has happened. Read the stories of free nations and the history of our own nation that allows us to live in free circumstances. Find books that talk about and teach the principles you want your family to understand and read them.
StopCSE.org. Do you have things that you would recommend for activists to do? Like if you want to go argue with your school board or show up to school board meetings or things like that, do you help people network for that kind of activity as well?
Yes, that's where the pedal hits the metal. So there's resources there and talking points and so forth. You can connect with others. There's a host of resources. You don't have to by yourself feel that you're fighting comprehensive sexuality education. There's a huge movement for it, but there's a huge movement against it.
That's right.
Most parents, when they hear it, they don't want their kid exposed to it, no matter what end of the political spectrum.
That's right. A lot of times people will say, well, our opponents are so well organized because they don't have any children and they're professional activists and we have jobs and we have families to raise. Listen, people. Because you have children, because you have grandchildren, you need to get organized and you need to be active. And permit me to say, Mrs. Kim Ells has 5 children, and somehow she makes it to the United Nations to get this kind of stuff done, okay? So no excuses, you got to get involved. And maybe you don't have a national platform, fine. Your local school board needs you and your input. Your neighbors need you to be involved. So that's... Yeah, I totally endorse that, and these resources that you'll find at stopcse.org are going to be a big help to you.
Right, and I think every person can be involved at the level that they are called to do. Like, I feel like as people get interested and involved, they'll be led to the things that they can do. And some people can do less, some people can do more. But everyone can do something. So let's all do something.
Exactly. Everyone can do something. And I think that's a great place to end. With this is Kim Ells, the author of The Invincible Family. Thank you so much for being a guest on the Dr. J Show.
Thanks, Dr. Morse.
You've been listening to the Dr. J Show, a production of the Ruth Institute. The Ruth Institute equips Christians to defend the family and build a civilization of love. Check out our website at ruthinstitute.org for helpful resources and support. Join us on Facebook. Our podcasts can also be found online at ruthinstitute.org. I'm Father Mark Hodges. Thank you for watching.